HarperCollins and Harper Audio present Reader, Come Home, The Reading Brain in a Digital World by Maryanne Wolfe. Read by Kirsten Potter. If we could modify the structure and wiring of the brain, that would be a fundamental game changer in terms of who we are, what we decide, what we think. We are in a different phase of evolution. The future of life is now in our hands. It is no longer just natural evolution, but human-driven evolution. Juan Enriquez and Steve Gullens. The question isn't what books will become in a world of electronic reading. The question is, what will become of the readers we've been? Verilyn Klinkenborg. Letter 1. Reading, The Canary in the Mind. Fielding calls out to you every few paragraphs as if to make sure you have not closed the book, and now I am summoning you up again, attentive ghost, dark silent figure standing in the doorway of these words. Billy Collins. Dear reader, you stand at the doorway of my words. Together, we stand at the threshold of galactic changes over the next few generations. These letters are my invitation to consider an improbable set of facts about reading and the reading brain, whose implications will lead to significant cognitive changes in you, the next generation, and possibly our species. My letters are also an invitation to look at other changes, more subtle ones, and consider whether you have moved, unaware, away from the home that reading once was for you. For most of us, these changes have begun. Let's begin with a deceptively simple fact that has inspired my work on the reading brain over the last decade and move from there. Human beings were never born to read. The acquisition of literacy is one of the most important epigenetic achievements of Homo sapiens. To our knowledge, no other species ever acquired it. The act of learning to read added an entirely new circuit to our hominid brain's repertoire. The long developmental process of learning to read deeply and well changed the very structure of that circuit's connections, which rewired the brain, which transformed the nature of human thought. What we read, how we read, and why we read change how we think, changes that are continuing now at a faster pace. In a span of only 6 millennia, reading became the transformative catalyst for intellectual development within individuals and within literate cultures. The quality of our reading is not only an index of the quality of our thought, it is our best-known path to developing whole new pathways in the cerebral evolution of our species. There is much at stake in the development of the reading brain and in the quickening changes that now characterize its current evolving iterations. You need only examine yourself. Perhaps you have already noticed how the quality of your attention has changed the more you read on screens and digital devices. Perhaps you have felt a pang of something subtle that is missing when you seek to immerse yourself in a once favorite book. Like a phantom limb, you remember who you were as a reader, but cannot summon that attentive ghost with the joy you once felt in being transported somewhere outside the self to that interior space. It is more difficult still with children, whose attention is continuously distracted and flooded by stimuli that will never be consolidated in their reservoirs of knowledge. This means that the very basis of their capacity to draw analogies and inferences when they read will be less and less developed. Young reading brains are evolving without a ripple of concern by most people, even though more and more of our youths are not reading other than what is required, and often not even that. TLDR, too long, didn't read. In our almost complete transition to a digital culture, we are changing in ways we never realized would be the unintended collateral consequences of the greatest explosion of creativity, invention, and discovery in our history. As I chronicle in these letters, there is as much reason for excitement as caution if we turn our attention to the specific changes in the evolving reading brain that are happening now and may happen in different ways in a few short years. This is because the transition from a literacy-based culture to a digital one differs radically from previous transitions from one form of communication to another. Unlike in the past, we possess both the science and the technology to identify potential changes in how we read, and thus how we think, before such changes are fully entrenched in the population and accepted without our comprehension of the consequences. The building of this knowledge can provide the theoretical basis for changing technology to redress its own weaknesses, whether in more refined digital modes of reading or the creation of alternative, developmentally hybrid approaches to acquiring it. What we can learn, therefore, about the impact of different forms of reading on cognition and culture has profound implications for the next reading brains. Thus equipped, we will have the capacity to help shape the changing reading circuits in our children and our children's children in wiser and better informed ways. I invite you into my collected thoughts on reading and the evolving reading brain as I would a friend at my door, with equal parts anticipation and delight at our exchanges about what reading means, beginning with the story of how reading became so important to me. To be sure, when I was a child learning to read, I did not think about reading. Like Alice, I simply jumped down reading's hole into Wonderland and disappeared for most of my childhood. When I was a young woman, I did not think about reading. I simply became Elizabeth Bennet, Dorothea Brooke, and Isabel Archer at every opportunity. Sometimes I became men like Alyosha Karamazov, Hans Castorp, and Holden Caulfield. But always I was lifted to places very far from the little town of El Dorado, Illinois, and always I burned with emotions I could never otherwise have imagined. Even when I was a graduate student of literature, I did not think very much about reading. Rather, I pored over every word, every encrypted meaning in the Duino elegies by Rilke and novels by George Eliot and John Steinbeck, and felt myself bursting with sharpened perceptions of the world and anxious to fulfill my responsibilities within it. I failed my first round at the latter miserably and memorably. With all the enthusiasm a young, flimsily prepared teacher can have, I began a Peace Corps-like stint in rural Hawaii, along with a small and wonderful group of fellow would-be teachers. There I stood daily before 24 unutterably beautiful children. They looked at me with complete confidence, and we looked at each other with total reciprocated affection. For a while, those children and I were oblivious to the fact that I could change the circumstances of their life trajectories if I could help them become literate, unlike many in their families. Then, only then, did I begin to think seriously about what reading means. It changed the direction of my life. With sudden and complete clarity, I saw what would happen if those children could not learn the seemingly simple act of passage into a culture based on literacy. They would never fall down a hole and experience the exquisite joys of immersion in the reading life. They would never discover Dinotopia, Hogwarts, Middle Earth, or Pemberley. They would never wrestle through the night with ideas too large to fit within their smaller worlds. They would never experience the great shift that moves from reading about characters, like the Lightning Thief and Matilda, to believing they could become heroes and heroines themselves. And most important of all, they might never experience the infinite possibilities within their own thoughts that emerge whole cloth from each fresh encounter with worlds outside their own. I realized in a whiplash burst that those children, all mine for 1 year, might never reach their full potential as human beings if they never learned to read. From that moment on, I began in earnest to think about reading's capacity to change the course of an individual life. What I hadn't a clue about then was the deeply generative nature of written language and what it means, literally and physiologically, for generating new thoughts. Not only for a child, but for our society. I also had no glimpse of the extraordinary cerebral complexity that reading involves, and how the act of reading embodies, as no other function, the brain's semi-miraculous ability to go beyond its original genetically programmed capacities, such as vision and language. That would come later, as it will in these letters. I revised my entire life plan and moved from the love of written words to the science beneath them. I set out to understand how human beings acquire written words and use written language to great advantage for their own intellectual development and that of future generations. I never looked back. Decades have passed since I taught the children of Waialua, now grown with children of their own. Because of them, I became a cognitive neuroscientist and a scholar of reading. More specifically, I conduct research on what the brain does when it reads and why some children and adults have greater difficulty learning how to read than others do. There are many reasons, from external causes such as children's impoverished environments to more biological reasons such as differences in the brain's organization of language in the grossly misunderstood phenomenon of dyslexia. But these are themes in other directions of my work and will make only cameo appearances in this book. These letters are concerned with a different direction of my work on the reading brain, the intrinsic plasticity that underlies it, with the unexpected implications that affect us all. My first inklings of the high stakes involved in the reading circuit's plasticity began more than a decade ago when I launched forth on what I thought would be a relatively circumscribed task. A researcher's account of reading's contributions to human development in Proust and the Squid, The Story and Science of the Reading Brain. My original intention was to describe the great arc of literacy's development and provide a new conceptualization of dyslexia that would describe the cerebral riches that are often wasted when people do not understand individuals whose brains are organized for language in a different way. But something unexpected happened as I wrote that book. Reading itself changed. What I knew as a cognitive neuroscientist and developmental psychologist about the development of written language had begun to shift before my eyes and under my fingers, and under everybody else's, too. For 7 years, I had studied the beginnings of Sumerian scripts and Greek alphabets and analyzed brain imaging data with my own brain largely buried in research. When I finished, I lifted my head to look about me and felt as if I were Rip Van Winkle. In the 7 years it had taken me to describe how the brain had learned to read over its close to 6,000-year history, our entire literacy-based culture had begun its transformation into a very different, digitally-based culture. I was gobsmacked. I rewrote the first historical chapters of my book to reflect the striking parallels between our present cultural shifts to a digital culture and the similar transition from the Greeks' oral culture to their extraordinary written one. That was comparatively simple, thanks to a critical tutorial given to me by a very generous classicist colleague, Stephen Hirsch. It was anything but simple, however, to use research on the existing expert reading brain to predict its next adaptation. And that is where I stopped in 2007. My self-appointed role as narrator of the research world's insights into reading's mind-changing capacities had moved out of my ken. There was almost no research being conducted then on the formation of a digital reading brain. There were no significant studies about what was happening in the brains of children, or adults, as they learned to read while immersed in a digitally dominated medium 6 to 7 hours a day, a figure that has since almost doubled for many of our youth. I knew how reading changes the brain and how the brain's plasticity enables it to be shaped by external factors, such as a particular writing system, for example, English versus Chinese. Unlike scholars in the past, such as Walter Ong and Marshall McLuhan, I never focused on the influences of the medium, for example, book versus screen, upon this malleable circuit structure. By the end of writing Proust and the Squid, however, I changed. I became consumed with how the circuitry of the reading brain would be altered by the unique characteristics of the digital medium, particularly in the young. The unnatural cultural origin of literacy, the first deceptively simple fact about reading, means that young readers do not have a genetically based program for developing such circuits. Reading brain circuits are shaped and developed by both natural and environmental factors, including the medium in which reading is acquired and developed. Each reading medium advantages certain cognitive processes over others. Translation? The young reader can either develop all the multiple deep reading processes that are currently embodied in the fully elaborated expert reading brain, or the novice reading brain can become short-circuited in its development, or it can acquire whole new networks in different circuits. There will be profound differences in how we read and how we think, depending on which processes dominate the formation of the young child's reading circuit. This leads us to the present moment and the difficult, more specific questions that arise for children raised within a digital milieu and ourselves. Will new readers develop the more time-demanding cognitive processes nurtured by print-based mediums as they absorb and acquire new cognitive capacities emphasized by digital media? For example, will the combination of reading on digital formats?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.